Students, let's today start with chapter 14, ecosystem. Now, what is an ecosystem? Ecosystem is the functional unit of nature where living organisms interact among themselves and also with the surrounding physical environment.
So, what are different types of ecosystems? Ecosystem can be natural or man-made. Natural can be further terrestrial or aquatic, and man-made can also be further terrestrial or aquatic. So if it is natural terrestrial ecosystem, so it could be the forest, grasslands or deserts. If it is natural aquatic ecosystem, so it could be ponds or natural lakes, sea, estuaries. Estuaries are the areas where the sea river meets the sea. Now in man-made ecosystems, there could be terrestrial, like a field crop that humans create, or maybe a garden, or in among the aquatic one, it could be an aquarium or a man-made lake. Now, what is the structure of ecosystem? Now, ecosystem can be recognized with the help of the type of species it is having. Suppose there is, it is dominated by rainforest trees, evergreen trees, so we call it as a rainforest ecosystem. Or if there are minimalistic plants, so we can say it is, or the desert plants, we say it is a desert kind of a ecosystem. And the other way will be the word called stratification. Stratification means it is the vertical distribution of different types of species of plants. For example, the trees occupying the various layers of the forest. What does this mean? That there are different types of plants. There are the one that will be near the land, that is the grasses. Then a bit little up will be the herbs, shrubs and the trees. So they form a vertical layer.
What are the functions of an ecosystem? So an ecosystem performs four basic functions: productivity, decomposition, energy flow and nutrient cycling. Let's start with productivity. Now what is productivity? Productivity is defined as the amount of biomass or organic matter produced per unit area over a time period by plants during photosynthesis. Now it is expressed, the units are important, it is expressed in the form of gram per meter square per year, or we can say it is kilocalories per meter square per year. Now productivity can further be gross primary productivity, GPP, or it could be the net primary productivity. Now gross primary productivity means the total amount of production of organic matter at the first trophic level, at the autotroph level. But suppose if we minus the respiration rate from that particular GPP, it becomes the net primary productivity. So gross primary productivity minus the respiration losses, the energy loss in that respiration of that organism, or the we call it as a net primary productivity. So the unit remains the same, gram per meter square per year or kilocalories per meter square per year. Similarly, what is secondary productivity? Secondary productivity means the accumulation of biomass at the heterotroph level. Heterotroph means I am talking about the herbivores and the decomposers. So again it could be a gross secondary productivity or it could be net secondary productivity. Gross means it is the total amount of productivity at that particular trophic level, and net means it is minus the respiratory losses. The second function of ecosystem is decomposition. So what is decomposition? It is the breakdown of complex organic matter into inorganic substances like carbon, carbon dioxide, water, nutrients, etc. So these dead plants remains, which are like leaves and bark and flowers and dead remains of the animal's fecal matter, they all constitute a word called detritus. So what are the various steps in a process of decomposition? Let's see. So the various steps will be, first will be fragmentation. Suppose the complex organic matter, they are converted into the simpler forms. So the first step will be fragmentation. So fragmentation is the breakdown of detritus into smaller particles. Now by the process of leaching, leaching means how the water takes the soluble things down into the soil. They are precipitated, they get precipitated as unavailable salts, and bacteria and fungal enzymes, they break down it into inorganic substances, and the process is called catabolism. So the next step is catabolism, where the microorganisms, they break them down, the smaller particles are broken down into inorganic substances. Then the next step is called humification. Now the detritus also has some organic matter. So what is humification? The invertebrates, they eat the detritus, and they when the these organic matter, they pass through the alimentary canal of these invertebrates. They are broken down into some amorphous dark colored substance called humus. Now this is resistant to microbial action, and the decomposition is very slow, and being colloidal in nature, this serves as a reservoir of nutrients. So this is what we say is the humus. Humus is the amorphous substance which is resistant to microbial action, and this will be decomposing but at a very slow rate. So that is what we say is humification. Then comes the mineralization. So this is slow, the humus is slowly degraded by microorganisms, and the inorganic substances, they are released. So that is the process called mineralization. Now during this whole process, there will be certain minerals that will be added up in the biomass of the microorganisms. So this will be non-available to the other organisms. This is called immobilization of minerals. Now what are the factors affecting the rate of decomposition? So the factors are oxygen, temperature, humidity, and also the type of substance that is being decomposed. Suppose it is rich in lignin and chitin, so there will be the rate will be lesser, yes, slower. And if it is rich in, if the substance is rich in nitrogen and water, or soluble in water, so this will be, the decomposition rate will be much faster. So the decomposition is faster in the warm and moist environment, and it will be slow in the dry and cool environmental conditions. So the next function of ecosystem is energy flow. Now except for the deep sea hydrothermal ecosystem, sun is the only source of energy for all ecosystems on earth. And of the total incident solar radiation, which is less than 50%, it is only photosynthetically active radiations. Let us see. Now for the total incidental solar radiation, it is only 50%, which we call as the PAR, photosynthetically active radiation. And out of this, only 2 to 10% of PAR is captured by plants as a gross primary productivity. And then out of that also, there is only 10%, that is only 1.6 to 8% of PAR, that will be the net primary productivity. And for the next trophic level, this will be just the 10% of this NPP that will be going to the next trophic level. Now this whole process of energy flow follows the laws of energy, the first law of thermodynamics and the second law of thermodynamics. The first law of thermodynamics, which states that energy is neither created nor destroyed, but can be only transferred from one component to another. So energy of sunlight cannot be transferred into energy of food and heat completely. So there will be some energy loss, and this energy loss is explained by the second law of thermodynamics, which states that energy transformation occurs spontaneously unless energy is degraded or dissipated from a concentrated to a dispersed form. Thus, in the ecosystem, the transfer of food energy from one organism to another leads to degradation and loss of major fraction of energy, food energy, as heat. And much of it is utilized in respiration. All the trophic levels in ecosystem, they are interconnected with the help of energy transfer. And this can also be explained with the help of a food chain and food web. Now, what is a food chain? The transfer of energy from one trophic level to the next trophic level, that is from producer to consumer, is called a food chain. And there are two types of food chains in nature. There could be grazing food chain and there could be detritus food chain. A grazing food chain extends from producers through herbivores to carnivores, like the cattle grazing in grassland, deer browsing in forests, and insects feeding in crops and trees. Whereas the detritus food chain begins with the dead organic matter and passes through the detritus feeding organisms in soil to organisms feeding on detritus feeders. larger amount of energy flows in detritus food chain as comparison to the grazing food chain. So these food chains, they are interconnected, and these interconnected food chains, they are called as the food webs.
Like this is a food chain, this is a grassland food chain, where the first trophic level is characterized by plants, the second by herbivores, third by carnivores, and the fourth trophic level is the top carnivores. Now this a grazing food chain is also found in the aquatic ecosystem. For example, in aquatic ecosystem like a pond, the phytoplanktons or the small grasses, seaweeds, they constitute the first trophic level, the zooplanktons the next, the grasshopper, zooplankton grasshopper, or some water plant weed feeding tadpole like larvae. Then there could be the fishes, or finally there could be some birds, fish eating birds. Now this is an example of a food web. Now sun's energy is utilized by the plants, and whatever is the biomass created will be fed upon by the larvae or the insects, and they'll be further fed upon by snails or birds, and then there could be the bird of prey at the highest trophic level. Now the trophic structure in an ecosystem can be represented by comparing standing crop. Now what is standing crop? It is either the number of individuals or the biomass or the energy fixed per unit area at different trophic levels by the organisms. Now this graphical representation of the trophic structure is done by drawing ecological pyramids. So let's talk about the ecological pyramids. Now there can be various parameters that we can take for considering or making a pyramid. So there could be a pyramid of biomass, there could be pyramid of numbers, and there could be pyramid of energy. So let's first talk about pyramid of numbers in a grassland ecosystem. So as in this pyramid, there's an upright pyramid that is shown here, and here it is various trophic levels that are shown. So the lowest trophic level, suppose it is the pyramid of numbers, so more organisms will be there in the primary producers, and as we move up the trophic levels, there will be lesser and lesser number of individuals. But this pyramid can be inverted if we talk about the pyramid that is characterized by big plants like ficus trees in a jungle. So there will be on a single ficus tree, there could be more insects feeding on the plant, or there could be many species of organisms feeding on the plant. Then there could be a pyramid of biomass. So this again, this whatever is shown here is a upright pyramid. So the biomass means I'm talking about the dry weight or the wet weight. Wet weight is I'm talking about the biomass of the organisms at this trophic level. So the biomass of the organisms at the primary producer level will always be more than that of the higher trophic levels. But this can be again inverted. Suppose if I take the example of phytoplanktons in a aquatic ecosystem, so there will be a larger standing crop of zooplankton that will be supported by the lesser biomass of phytoplanktons. So the pyramid of number as well as pyramid of biomass can be inverted in certain examples. But the pyramid of energy can never be inverted, because energy cannot flow in the opposite direction. Energy cannot be created or destroyed. So the pyramid of energy will always be an upright pyramid. Another topic in this chapter is ecological succession. Now what is ecological succession? It is the gradual and fairly predictable changes in the species composition of a given area. Now any environment cannot be same forever. Now for example, there's a barren rock at somewhere in the ecosystem, so that will never be barren rock forever. It will be inhabited by some lichens. They'll start growing there, and when they die, they'll be adding a lot of organic matter into that place, and this is called the moss stage or the lichen stage. And slowly there'll be a little bit of organic matter and some minerals added, and this will be followed by some annual herb stage, followed by perennial herb stage, scrub, that is the shrubs, and then a climax community is established, that is a forest community. Now, this kind of changes, this kind of sequential gradual changes that will occur in an area or a barren rock is what we say is a xerarch. Xerarch, xera means dry. So, on a dry barren land, the sequential changes, they are xerarch. Now, the first stage that comes here, the first living organisms, they are called the pioneers. The last is called the climax community. And the in-between stages are called the seral stages. Another such succession is the aquatic hydrarch in an aquatic environment. And this is initiated by a phytoplankton stage. This will occur in a newly created water body only. So the first stage is called phytoplankton stage or the pioneer stage. This is followed by submerged plant stage, submerged free floating plant stage, reed swamp, marsh meadow, scrub, and lastly followed by a climax community. Now these are the sequential changes occurring in an aquatic water body, and these changes, they'll be leading to the establishment of a climax community. So whatever may be the type of succession, it will always lead to a climax community, that is a forest community. Now again, the in between stages, they are called the seral stages. So suppose if I say what are the differences between seral and climax community, seral stages and climax community. So the size of individual ecological niches, niches means the functional role of the species. There'll be few individuals and the different types of species existing there. But in the climax, there'll be many. In fact, this is the more specialized and complex. And as per as the functions, in the seral stages, there'll be simple functions, there'll be simple food chains, whereas in the climax, there'll be complex. So, in fact, the nutrient conservation will also be the highest in the climax community. So, seral stages are the in-between stages. The first is always the pioneer, in-between are the serals, and the last one is always the climax community. The next thing is nutrient cycling. This is also called the biogeochemical cycles. Now, these nutrient cycles are of two types. They could be gaseous or they could be sedimentary. Gaseous type ka matlab hoga, this means that the reservoir is in the air or water. For example, the carbon cycle, the oxygen cycle, and the nitrogen cycle. But the sedimentary type is the reservoir is the rocks, and that is there is one that is called the phosphorus cycle. So let's see the first one, carbon cycle. Now the carbon cycle, the reservoir is atmosphere and water. So it is around 71% of carbon is in the sea and 1% lies in the atmosphere, and these two are called the reservoir. So this is a gaseous type of nutrient cycle. So there could be reservoir in the form of oil, gas, limestone, dolomite, these kind of ores, they'll be there below the soil, and there could be coal deposits, and when these things are burned, combustion will be happening, so there will be a lot of CO2 released. Burning leads, forest fire leads to a lot of CO2 released into the atmosphere, and then when the CO2 is utilized by the plants, and these die and decay, so again the cycle continues. Similarly, in the aquatic water body, there will be photosynthesis by the aquatic plants, weeds, phytoplanktons, and CO2 will be added into the water. So these organisms will decay, and a lot of calcium is occupied in the calcareous sediments of the animals, mollusk shells, and this way the cycle keeps on happening. Then another type of gaseous type of nutrient cycle is the nitrogen cycle. So again, the atmosphere is the reservoir. From the atmosphere, this nitrogen is fixed with the help of microorganisms, or maybe because of some chemical activities like in the atmosphere, or maybe because of lightning. This is what we say is the nitrogen fixation. So this fixed soil is in the form of ammonium ions. These ions are converted into nitrites with the help of some microorganisms like nitrosomonas. And with the help of these nitrobacters, microorganisms, it is converted to soil nitrate. So this is what will be taken up by the plants, fed upon by the consumers, and when all of them they die, again this is in the form of ammonia, by the process of ammonification again added into the soil. Similarly, there will be a certain amount of nitrogen that will be seeping off or running off along with the water, that may get dissolved and run off or go out of this ecosystem. There will be some wet and dry deposit. Wet and dry deposit means from the atmosphere directly there could be some deposition into the soil because of some chemical activities in the atmosphere, and this way the nitrogen keeps on moving around and around in the atmosphere. Now, example of sedimentary type of cycle, nutrient cycle, is the phosphorus cycle. And you know, phosphorus is basically found in the rock minerals, and when it is getting dissolved in water, so this forms the soil solution. And from this solution, there from this soil, they'll be uptaken by the plants, producers, consumed by the consumers, and finally, when they die, the detritus is again added into the soil. So there could be some amount that is what we call as a runoff. Runoff means again dissolved in water and moving out of the ecosystem. Finally, let us see what are the ecosystem services. Now, suppose if we start paying the ecosystem, the environment, so let us see how much we need to pay. It was Robert Constanza and his colleagues who gave a price tag to nature's life support services. And what they calculated was that we need to pay $33 trillion to the nature for whatever the nature is doing for us. So this is for the this nutrient cycle, all the functions of ecosystem, like the nutrient fixation, recreation, nutrient cycling, decomposition, and providing this climate and regulating the climate and providing habitat for wildlife. So this is how much amount we need to pay to the environment.